Good evening and welcome to Q&A live from Her Majesty's Theatre in Adelaide. I'm Tony Jones and joining us tonight, former Howard Government Minister Amanda Vanstone, South Australian Labor Premier Jay Weatherill, Education and Training Minister Simon Birmingham and the Shadow Minister for Foreign Affairs Penny Wong. Please welcome our panel. Thank you. Now, Q&A is live in the eastern states on ABC TV. It's live on News 24 everywhere else, including South Australia. And you can also watch and listen live on iView, News Radio and Facebook. Well, tonight's audience has sent some great questions in. Let's go to our first one. It's from Tim Powell.
Good evening, Tony, and good evening, panel. My question's for Senator Birmingham. The independent Gonski needs-based reforms has the support of the overwhelming majority of educators across the country as the best way to improve learning outcomes for students. Principals and teachers are already seeing positive results. If you plan on changing the funding agreements, why were the relevant state education ministers not briefed or included in discussions prior to your media announcement on Wednesday? Do you believe this type of informed by media approach to communication between federal and state politicians is constructive?
Welcome to Q&A.
Thanks very much, Tony. Tim, thanks for your question. Happy to set the record straight on a couple of things there. Firstly, what I told and said before the meeting that we would happen with state ministers was we'd have a conversation about the principles to take us forward in relation to school funding. Principles based on what the Liberal Party and the National Party, the Turnbull government, took to the last election. We took to the last election a clear policy that said we would grow school funding in Australia from the federal government from $16 billion this year in 2016 to more than $20.1 billion by 2020. That's growth that's above enrolments, above inflation, it's real growth into Australian schools. That we wanted to make sure it was distributed according to need, equitably across Australia, and used to leverage reforms in our schools.
But without the money originally agreed to?
Not as much as the Labor Party had promised on the Never Never, beyond the budget forward estimates, without any clear idea as to how it would be paid for. So yes, a distinction. And we were quite honest about that distinction, and I made that very clear in numerous interviews pre-election. What I said to the state ministers was I wanted to start at a first principles conversation. So that's what we did. We talked about the principles, how the current funding model actually differs from what David Gonski and his panel recommended, because it does differ quite significantly. David Gonski and the panel wrote a very worthwhile report that has some good principles in it, particularly in terms of ensuring that you provide greater support to areas of need, such as students from low SES backgrounds, Indigenous students, students with a disability, etc. So we talked through how some of those differences in terms of that model have occurred, the fact that we actually have not one funding model from the federal government, but 27 different funding models across the country that sees us providing for identical students in identical looking schools from the same demographic background, different levels of federal funding across the country. Currently, around $1,500 difference for a student, growing to more than $2,000 difference per student in disadvantaged localities by 2019, if we let the current arrangements go as they do.
You could probably talk. You could easily talk for the whole program. We'll come back to you.
No, we're not going to let you.
They won't let you.
No, we can't let you do that. But we'll come back to you. I want to hear from Jay Weatherill first of all. Based on the question we just heard, were you taken by surprise?
Yes. We were, but look, here's a principle that we should start with. We just heard a bit about principles. The principle of keeping your word. And that's what happened at the last federal election. There was a commitment in relation to Gonski funding. Remember, a unity ticket with Labor in relation to school funding. Now, $80 billion worth of funding was cut from health and education. And that first hockey budget, we all know about it, the 2014 hockey budget, is still a political price that has not been paid by this government. Now, I feel sorry for Simon. These are decisions that are taken well above his head. He's got to work through with the money that he has to be able to allocate that to the states. So there's not a lot he can do about this. But what the Prime Minister can do is to put back in the funding that was cut. Now, remember why we had that funding. We had that funding because we've got a great education system in this nation. But in OECD terms, it's an unequal education system. That means that it's a very steep graph. The top kids are going great, but at the bottom, there are kids that are missing out. What Gonski funding means is to get money into schools to help those kids with learning needs. I can give you an example of a school up at Murray Bridge. The principal tells me there that about 30% of his time is about managing behavioural issues. That means that's 30% of his day that is not allocated to teaching and learning. Why would we expect the sort of learning outcomes for kids to be any different unless we can meet those needs? That's what Gonski's all about, and they have ripped out, in South Australia's terms, $335 million over the next 2 years.
OK, that's the figure I wanted to know. You're saying you're going to be out of pocket as a state $335 million, is that
correct? Yep, over the next 2 years.
Over 2 years. Amanda Vanstone, you wanted to come in. I'll come back to you on those figures in a minute. Yes.
I just want to make the point that, you know, I feel a bit sorry for Gonski. He doesn't need my sympathy. He's perfectly capable of looking after himself. But not everybody appreciates that Gonski's view is expressed within his terms of reference, which had a clause that had, you know, no losers. And successive governments...
So no school be worse off, effectively. That's how that
roughly.
Was...
Roughly. I mean, what it means
when
is...
When you say no losers, that's how it was
put pretty much. The previous Liberal and Labor governments, both have done this, and no point in denying it, have bought off the education sector at election times and done sweetheart deals, and they've grandfathered things. So you've now got this tremendous disparity, and people say, well, that's what Gonski wanted. Well, that's what he said within the terms of reference that he was given. And I personally think sooner or later our government has to undo those grandfathering clauses.
So let me just clear that one up. You're saying that the idea that no school should be worse off is wrong, that some schools should have funding taken from them. Is that what you're suggesting?
Look, you'd have to phase it in because, you know, we have become a country where you can't take anything from anyone, otherwise you're a terrible person. But the facts are some schools are getting a lot more than others, as Simon says, and within the whole system. Disparities of up to, say, 1,500 now between two kids in the same circumstances. They're all Australians. It shouldn't be happening.
Penny Wong,
Thank you. Well, can I first... Simon talks about first principles. Let's remember what the first principles are. The reason we all went down a needs-based funding model was to try and resolve the issues that our education system presents, one of which is we have a reasonably good education system in this country, but still one of the best things an Australian child can do for their educational outcomes is to choose their parents' postcode carefully. So there was a judgment that that was not a sensible thing for a country with our relative affluence and also with our sense of a fair go. It makes sense from an economic perspective. It also is the right thing to do. Now, we all know over the last years we've seen a lot of things said by the Liberal Party. I can remember Christopher Pyne telling everybody there wasn't going to be a cigarettes paper between what the Labor Party was promising and what the Liberal Party would deliver. Well, we know that was not true.
Can you just tell me what you say the difference is between the original funding that was that the Labor Party said it was going to give in the out years, years 5 and 6 of Gonski, and what the government's actually promising? Because can we get that figure on the table?
Well, the figure that I think the Grattan Institute talks about is $3.8 billion less nationally in 2018 and 2019. So $3.8 billion less. But can I just come back to the question, though, which was, why are you doing this? There's a reason why Simon's doing this. There's a reason why he ran the lines again today about 27 different formulas, et cetera, et cetera, is he doesn't want to fund the agreements that were made. So he's got to go out there in the national papers and say, oh, all these agreements are really bad and this is the problem with them, because fundamentally they don't want to stump up the funding that was in the budget, that was allocated, and that was the subject of agreements with the states to try and improve the educational outcomes for Australian students, regardless of where they live.
Now, just before you come in, I just want to quickly quiz Penny Wong on this one thing, because you said that Labor went for a needs-based model. Ken Boston, who's a key member of the panel, said you did not. He's called your system a corruption of the Gonski report, and he says effectively the needs-based loading that ended up being decided by Canberra bureaucrats was pulled out of thin Canberra air. He said it doesn't really exist. It didn't follow what they suggested should happen.
Well, obviously you have to implement the principles in a report, and you also have to deal with the real-world issue of how you negotiate with states, the different budgetary positions of the states. So some states were prepared to put in more money early on in agreements than other states, or they were more able to.
But that does corrupt children, treating children in the same need in the same way.
That may be true, but what you're actually advocating, Amanda, as I understand it, and I doubt that the Liberal Party would ever endorse this, is taking money off schools that already have money, and I don't think your constituency would let you do that.
I'm coming back to Simon. I'll let you comment on what we were just talking about there, but the $3.8 billion is what's being claimed is the missing money, the money that your government originally agreed to put into education, schools funding, and is no longer doing. Do you accept that figure, first of all?
Tony, it was never there, is the first point I'd make. It was always beyond the budget forward estimates.
So you're saying the promise was never there or the money was never there?
The money was never there.
Well, I mean, on that basis, the defence budget is not funded. On that basis, the defence capability budget, which goes for years, is not funded.
Kenny.
I mean, it's ridiculous. Kenny, there are 5 and 10 year funding models.
You never had a clear pathway, and this is funding that becomes...
It's a line to accept, it's a line to justify cutting the funding.
This is funding that becomes, of course, a new baseline upon which future growth occurs, so it's actually funding that ultimately, when you keep growing the size of government spending and then you inflate it from there into the future, it obviously has a continuing problem in terms of how you repair the budget. But the point I'd make in terms of the fairness of the arrangements that were put in place is if you listen to Penny and to Jay, you get the impression that in 2019 it's okay if you actually let all of Labor's deals sort themselves out, everybody's in the same category. But by 2019, a disadvantaged student in a South Australian school will still receive less federal funding than a disadvantaged student in a school in New South Wales or in Victoria or in the Northern Territory. Was that a good deal that you signed up to, Jay? Was that a good arrangement for South Australia? Is that equitable that the same disadvantaged student in the same disadvantaged school in South Australia is getting less than in those three jurisdictions, let alone, of course, an identical student in Western Australia gets dramatically less than in any of those cases?
Right, now you asked a rhetorical states. Question of the Premier. Well, we better hear his answer.
Well, it's better than the deal you're offering me. And look, the point is, the point is this.
We actually don't know that, Jay, because I'm inviting you
to
participate
in a discussion about
it. Well, you haven't
actually offered a deal to the media.
Look, if this money isn't real that you say that was cut from the budget, how on earth can you count it as a budget saving? How can you publish a set of budgets which said that you're going to make an $80 billion saving out of health and education cuts if that money wasn't real? If it wasn't there to cut, how can it actually show up in your account? So the truth is it is real. And the other thing about it is this, is that this is the last thing you cut, not the first thing you cut. Health and education represent one of the most fundamental and successful elements of the Australian project. It is the thing by which we actually create equity and prosperity for our nation. And I think people are proud of our public healthcare system, they're proud of our education system, and they want them supported and they want them funded first.
Okay, I'm just going to go to another question on this subject. The question is from Pam Kent. She's the president of the South Australian Primary Principals Association.
Good evening. Senator Birmingham, I have a question for you. We know that Australia's funding in education is generous compared to other OECD countries, but we also know that we have a very high rating of inequitable distribution of funding to our schools through the federal funding. How can you justify allocating generous amounts to wealthy schools when impoverished and disadvantaged students attending their local public school need so much more support?
Well, thanks, Anne. And let me try to answer your question and pick up on a couple of other points. We hear Jay talk about cuts, and I just want to reinforce for the audience. Federal funding to Australian schools grows from $16 billion this year to more than $20 billion by 2020. Now, are we promising to spend as much as Labor promised to spend? No, I've been perfectly honest about that. But is it growing funding above enrolments, above inflation? Absolutely. So funding is in no way, shape or form being cut or going backwards. It is growing into the future. I've also been crystal clear all along that I want to make sure the funding we have available to us is distributed fairly and according to need. Now, Anne, as you know, historically what's happened in Australia is that the states and territories have the primary Commonwealth responsibility, or the primary responsibility under our constitution, for funding education. And overwhelmingly, they pay the bills in government schools, and it is a historical quirk that the Commonwealth has funded more into the non-government sector. But we are now funding at record levels into the government sector, and I'm proud of that fact. The share of funding that we meet for government schools is higher than it's ever been before, and that share will keep growing under the term
of government. Okay, well, you've made that point. I'm going to bring you to the question now, because the question was about wealthy schools, and it actually brings up the point that Amanda Vanstone made just a moment ago, which is that when Gonski did his review, had one hand tied behind his back, because he was made to do this within the context of no school being worse off, which means you can't take money away from wealthier schools. Should that change, as Amanda Vanstone says?
Well, that's not a promise that I've ever made, and I've been very cautious not to do so.
Which is because you've not made the promise that no school will be worse off.
Correct.
So some schools could be worse off.
Well, Tony, I've deliberately not made that promise.
Well, I'm asking, I want to hear from the other side of the equation. If you're not making the promise, does that mean you are saying some schools could be worse off or will be worse off?
That is possible, because under the arrangements we have, some schools who are notionally overfunded under the models, the 27 different models we have, some schools that are notionally overfunded take more than 100 years to come into alignment with the current funding model. That's the deal that Penny's government did.
So now, can I just confirm this? The ones that are overfunded, you must have a list of them, do you?
If you want me to create a hit list or something tonight, Tony, that's not about to happen.
But do you know that some schools are overfunded?
We do, Tony.
So how many?
Well, that depends, of course, how you actually measure what a funding benchmark is. I mean, we're not talking vast numbers, but there are some. And there are some, thanks to the type of special deals.
Are the wealthier private schools overfunded, to go back to the question?
There are some that fit that bill. Yes, there are.
So some private schools could expect, under your governorship of this, to lose money?
Well, Tony, that depends on whether we can actually reach some accord with the states and territories and ultimately with the Senate to get a fairer funding model in place. Now, I want, within the money that's available, within the money that Australia can afford, to get the fairest funding model we can possibly have for Australian schools. And that will be one, from my perspective, that is based on need, that treats the states and territories equitably from a federal perspective, and of course then puts the burden back on them to make sure they live up to their end of the bargain as well. Because if they don't pay their fair share, we'll never meet the types of challenges that you're talking about.
Okay, I'm just going to quickly go back to former Education Minister, Amanda Vanstone.
There's just two things I want to say. You know, it's an interesting debate. We always have this argument between the Commonwealth and the states, and the previous government, now the opposition, always argues with whoever's in government. It's all very interesting. But we all agree that kids' best chance is a decent education. And some of the debate should shift from being about the funding to why we've put, despite the fact that we've put increasing funding into education, which presumably we all support, we have not always got better results for it. And the only reason we put extra money in is because we believe in the substance of education, not just more money for you and shut up. You know, more money and we want it to be better. And there are so many circumstances where it isn't. And I'd like
Amanda,
to see...
Amanda, can I just make this point? The Gonski review... I'm agreeing with you.
Yeah.
The Gonski review found that the big issue... issue with low-performing schools was not teacher quality, but the magnitude of the task they face. And the Gonski panel said the problem for teachers in disadvantaged schools is that their numbers are inadequate. They lack specialist support, like counsellors, speech therapists, interpreters, school family liaison officers, and so on and so forth. Do you agree with that?
Well, what it says is that the extra money we've been putting in hasn't been going to the things that will produce better educational outcomes.
And then it points
That's
to
why
these
we believe
things,
in education,
but it points to these things as being the keys that are missing.
Well, that might be right, but I'm just making the point that we've had this increased funding. For decades we've been putting more money in, and we haven't got substantially better results, and we should be having a debate about it. I don't mean now, but that's the central issue. Are kids getting a better chance? That's the central issue.
Jay Weatherill,
now, the other quick point I want to make about...
No, I'm being told we need to move on to other questions, so I want to hear from Jay Weatherill on the point just made by the Minister, which is that some schools may be worse off. Is that a good idea?
Well, look, an agreement was reached. We just want the agreement on it. But look, can I say there's another whole dimension to this, and I do agree that we need to focus on not just the school but the years before the school. And one of the things I think hopefully Simon and I can agree about is the need to increase our investment into the early years, and in particular kindergarten, the year before primary school, and maybe even to create an opportunity to extend preschool into three-year-olds. So I think there are great opportunities to actually affect children. So the biggest changes, frankly, can occur in those years between birth and five. That's where you can get a profound influence on the outcome in school. And I think there's a lot of common ground that we can reach there.
I just want to quickly go back to our questioner. You asked a question about wealthy schools. Are you happy that the minister has responded in the way that he did?
Not entirely.
Well, I'll take that as a comment. Penny Wong, do you want to make a comment about that? You've just heard what sounded like a policy shift as we're talking about.
It was interesting, yes. Mm. But I think this is the problem, isn't it, with the sort of dialogue through the media. If Simon has a proposition, he should put it to the states and territories.
But Penny, if I didn't consult with the states and territories,
well, you're not
first,
consulting. No, no, no. You're talking to the media about why there's current agreements are so bad.
This is actually explaining policy to the public, Penny. I think that's why we're here.
This is true.
In fairness, and if I went to the states and territories and simply said, "Here is the Birmingham designed proposal," then I'd be lambasted for not talking to them, listening to them, and consulting with them first.
Well, it's good that you're consultative.
We have until the first half of 2017 to get this resolved. That's what Jay and the Prime Minister and first leaders around the country agreed. So I actually want to work with people to try to get a better, fairer model that makes the best use of the dollars
we've got.
I've got
one quick follow-up question, because one of the critical things the Gonski report said, the recommendations were that there should be a national schools resourcing body, an independent group, which looked at which schools were getting how much money and gave advice as to whether that was a good thing. Would you go back to that? Because that was at the essence of what the Gonski report recommended, and it was rejected by the previous government.
If the states and territories are willing to do so, I'm very open to that idea. There's no point having such a body if the only ones who allow it to direct resourcing is the federal government. So you actually need the states and territories to play ball.
Would you like to have such a body if the states and territories agreed to it?
I think so, and part of the argument Ken Boston, one of the authors of the Gonski report, makes is exactly the one Amanda was making before, that such a body can also have a look at what is working in terms of the evidence to improve outcomes in schools. Not just have a debate, as we've had largely tonight, entirely about how much money's there and how you carve it up, but actually a fair income analysis of what makes the best difference to lift outcomes for Australian school children.
Okay, we'll leave that.
Can I just make that point? Very briefly. It's just important to remember, whatever you think about private schools and people can afford to send their kids there, that those kids are much less expensive for the taxpayer because their families are contributing. They do get some money, and I know some people would prefer private schools not to. But if every parent took their kid out of private schools and went into public schools, the education bill would soar. And there'd be, you know, classes stuffed with more people. We'd have a much bigger problem.
Or we'd have an education system like France and Germany.
Well, you might like that, but I like a system where parents have the choice whether they want to kick extra money in. And if they do, it means less money the taxpayer has to put in. I personally think that's a good thing, if that's what the parents want to choose to do.
Thank you, Amanda. Remember, if you hear any doubtful claims on Q&A, send a tweet using the hashtags FactCheck and Quanda, and look for fact checks by the expert researchers at the Conversation website. And the next question comes from Lucina Zvolsky.
Thank you, Tony. After more than 60 years of nuclear power, with hundreds of thousands of tons of nuclear waste in temporary storages all over the world, there's not one permanent storage of this waste anywhere. Finland has had over 40 years of consultation and planning, but is still years away from taking waste. And its waste is 20 times smaller than what is proposed here, and it's only their own waste. So, Mr. Weatherill, if this is such a good idea, and it's a financial windfall, as you claim, why is South Australia the only state in the only country in the world vying for this privilege?
Jay Weatherill.
It's an excellent question. Listener, it's an excellent question, and it's a question that I've posed to South Australians without, at this stage, promoting an answer. South Australia has about 25% of the world's uranium deposits, and so we export our uranium to the world. Given the circumstances that South Australia faces at the moment in terms of the transformation of its economy, we're interrogating all of our opportunities. It seems sensible for us to ask the question, could we play a deeper role in the nuclear fuel socket? So I created a royal commission to essentially analyse that question, to equip the community with the factual information to allow them to essentially participate in this debate. That royal commission found that we should do mine, and we should expand that opportunity. There's no near-term opportunity in relation to enrichment or even in nuclear power. But what the Royal Commission did find is that there is a potential opportunity in relation to the storage of spent fuel from other nations. You're right, other nations have not found a solution for this. The most advanced nation is Finland, and it, after 38 years now, has found a solution. I was there last week, and it's a sophisticated scientific proposition. There are many differences, though, between South Australia and Finland. The first, as you've noted, is a long history, about a 50-year history of nuclear energy, a well-respected regulator, and a burning platform, really something they have to deal with because they've got to store this waste. We don't have that problem, but there are a lot of countries in the world that have this problem. Their countries, through circumstances, either geology or population, mean that it's difficult for them to find a place. And the
so can I put this to you? Do you have a kind of vision here? Could South Australia become one day the world capital of nuclear waste?
We could if the community chose to do that. And the
would you put it on your number plates?
They won't choose to be the dump state.
Well, you could make fun of it, or you could decide to explore what is estimated to be conservatively a $50 billion opportunity for South Australia. And also, if you regard yourself as an international citizen, if this is indeed the best place in the world to store waste, which has to exist somewhere in the world, it's not going away, and many countries are just leaving them at the moment in their cooling ponds next to their nuclear reactors, it's a contribution that we could make internationally. Now, it is a very big call, I appreciate that, and it's not one that would be taken anytime soon. It's something that we've subjected to the most sophisticated and deep community consultation process that's ever been undertaken in this state.
Would you have to change Labor Party policy in order to do it?
Of course.
Federally, yes.
Of course,
yep.
State and federal.
Yeah. Amanda.
Look, one of the benefits of getting into your dotage is you've got and not losing your memory yet, is you remember Normie Foster. Remember Normie Foster? The Labor Party just about wanted to kill him because he agreed that Roxby Downs should go ahead. I remember that. They hated him. He was a traitor, didn't like him at all. Then I remember when your predecessor was leaving and he hung around for a few weeks because he wanted to make the announcement about the huge Roxby expansion. That didn't happen either. Monarto, that's a zoo. That was going to be another big city, you know, like new outpost city. What was the other? The multifunction polis. So, you know, don't get too excited about this. I think it is an issue worth looking at, but it's a distraction from the real problems we face in South Australia.
Okay, Penny Wong, if it's a... what do you say? Could it be a $50 billion opportunity?
Well, I think it's a pretty...
As Bob Hawke suggests.
It's a pretty controversial idea. It's an idea that is... would require, if the government were to go down this path, some changes to Labor policy, including federally. I've had a lot of people raise concerns with this with me. Some of them I share. But I think that Jay is doing the right thing, going through a sensible process. I think Jay put it well. He said if this were to fly, there would have to be essentially community consent and a social licence to operate. In the absence of that, I can't see... that the proposition will succeed.
Now, does being pro-business as a Liberal minister mean you're pro that kind of business?
If first and foremost, the safeguards have to stack up, and secondly, the economics have to stack up. You'd say thirdly as well, the politics have to stack up, and Jay obviously has a task to get the rest of the Labor Party on side and to actually ensure that whilst federal coalition government would be willing, if South Australia chooses to work constructively with you on this, there's no guarantees that a federal Labor government would. So I think there are a lot of questions to be answered. And I just hope, though, I hope that Amanda's not right, that this isn't just a great big smokescreen or distraction, and that
no,
we don't wake up sometime
at,
next
don't,
year and
don't
find...
Don't count on anything happening soon.
No, wake up next relevance. Year, though, and find that it sort of was all a great big hoax that kept South Australians thinking, oh, well, there's this potential big thing around the corner, actually the state Labor government was either never really serious about it or could never actually get support even from within its own ranks to proceed.
Okay, we've got another question on this. It's from Karina Lester.
First of all, I just want to acknowledge the traditional lands that we stand on, the Kaurna people. I'm the youngest daughter of Yami and Lucy Lester. So Yami was blinded by the nuclear British tests at the Emu Fields in 1953. I'm also granddaughter of Eileen Gumbelwater Brown, who was quite instrumental in the Irrawaddy campaign and was supported by the Kupapiti Gungulurra as well. So my question is to Premier Jay Weatherill now. Wanting to ask a question about, you have said that consent of traditional owners is essential for a nuclear waste dump before a nuclear waste dump would be considered. Yet, ever since the Royal Commission first proposed a dump, a majority of Aboriginal people have consistently said no, despite that your government has proceeded to push ahead with a rushed, insensitive and culturally inappropriate consultation process. How will you and your government measure our consensus, and when will our voices be heard and respected?
Well, thank you, Karina, and I know that this obviously is a profoundly important issue for you and your community, especially your father, who's been such an important campaigner for Aboriginal rights, and in particular for his people in the north west corner of our state, the APY lands. Can I say that from the outset, the Royal Commission identified a critical element of this is community consent, and he described the consent in two ways. One is social consent, the whole community, so the whole South Australian community. But then in terms of a place for a location for such a facility, if one were to exist, it would need specific community consent. And that would require, essentially, the explicit consent of traditional owners. Now, if that didn't exist, it won't happen. That's the experience in Finland. Essentially, a capacity for community consent was built into their process. And what that gave them was a sense of comfort that this thing wasn't going to happen unless they agreed to it. We have been travelling across the whole of the state. We've reached out to every community. We have a consultative committee that sits on top of this that's led by former federal court judge, Justice Mansfield, who is a well-respected judge who has played a big role in native title cases. We have Parry Aegis, an Aboriginal man who's helping us design our engagement with Aboriginal people, and we're trying to reach out. If we've been ineffective in doing that, we'll have to try harder. But this process is not going to finish quickly. It's going to be an ongoing process, and we have to deeply engage with Aboriginal people, and ultimately, nothing's going to be forced on Aboriginal people.
Just a very brief follow-up. I'll come back to you, Karina, in 2 seconds. Is there a way of offering financial incentives to the Indigenous communities?
Of course. I mean, that would be a necessary part of this. But there's a precondition, I think, for some communities. Some communities simply wouldn't agree with this, whatever the money was, whatever the financial benefits were. So we first need to grapple with that, but there would be profound benefits for communities. That's what we saw in Finland. Very great opportunities for financial benefits which improve services and opportunities for people.
Okay, let's go back to Karina. You wanted, you have to stand up, thanks.
Yeah, the question was that you're now pushing to the citizens jury number 2, and so you're on a timeline. November is when you're hoping to have that final report by the end of that consultation process. That doesn't give people time to really digest
okay.
and understand
I'll just clarify that,
that
for you.
So
yeah.
You are not allowing for that conversation and the discussion to happen. And Aboriginal people, have said no and consistently say no to this. Because the location of this, if it was to go ahead, is not going to be here in Adelaide. It's going to be north of Port Augusta, which is going to impact on Arnawadjuta and Aboriginal people from that north area right up to the top of the state.
Well, maybe and maybe not, Karina. I mean, the site hasn't been chosen. And can I say that the point of the citizens' jury is, and also the consultations, which are probably more important, going out and speaking to people, is to gather perspectives. So that second citizens' jury will bring your perspective into the process, and that will be profoundly important for the next steps we take. No decisions, no quick decisions are going to be taken. We will take a preliminary view of things by the end of the year, but that will largely be, I think, a decision about whether to say no, we're not interested at all, or a decision to take a further extensive period of discussion. Look, Finland took 38 years. It's not going to happen anytime soon if it happens at all.
Okay, we're going to move on to other questions. The next question is from Tamara Hutchins.
Mr. Birmingham, how can the Prime Minister agree to take refugees from Central America when so few of the Iraqi and Syrian refugees that were promised asylum have been settled in Australia, and when there are still a significant number of people suffering on Manus Island and Nauru? Shouldn't the priority be with fulfilling the promises already made?
We'll start with Simon Birmingham. Go ahead.
Tamara, I'm proud that we're able to increase our refugee intake as Australia to a higher level permanently, approaching 19,000 people per annum. That means we continue as a nation to sit as one of the most generous countries in the world in terms of resettling refugees. One of the reasons why we're able to do that and think we can do it with community support is because we've gotten back to a point where we actually are in control of ensuring that those people who we are accepting as refugees, we have assessed to be the most needy, the most worthy, coming from overseas through all of the proper processes and channels. Now, we are working as hard as we can to ensure people on Manus and Nauru are resettled or return to their homelands where that's possible. And that's important that that work continues.
Should there be, can I say, because that was the core of the question, should there be some kind of time limit on how long people are held indefinitely in those centres? Manus Island is closing, but Nauru is not. Should there be a time limit in your view, or should people be held there indefinitely?
Well, Tony, there are options in terms of being able to go into the Papua New Guinea community, into the Nauru community, as well as returning to homelands for people in those settings. But offshore detention is a key factor in the success we have had in stopping illegal arrivals to Australia, and in doing that, in stopping deaths at sea and ensuring that we actually build the community support to have a generous humanitarian intake of refugees.
So the core of the question was about the agreement to take Central American refugees, and it would be assumed, I suppose, that if you took Central American refugees, then some of those people who need to be resettled from Manus and Nauru would go in the other direction as part of a kind of swap. Is that entirely ruled out, or is it a secret we just don't know about?
Well, there's no deal for a swap. I think everybody involved in these discussions have been crystal clear about that. But obviously, we are working with countries all over the world to try to successfully resettle those and Manus and Nauru who aren't going to go back to
their homeland. Is the United States one of those countries?
Well, we're talking with anybody and any nation who will happily engage with us in those discussions. We want to support those individuals to be successfully resettled or to return to their homelands where that's possible. But we want to make sure that there is no hint, no chink in the armour, as we saw when Kevin Rudd unravelled the successful Howard government policies, that take us back to a position where we have a steady flow of boats coming to Australia, where we tragically have lives lost at sea, and where we then start to undermine that community support that is essential to be able to take the increased numbers of refugees we are taking.
Let's hear from another panellist, Penny Wong.
Well, first on the Syrian intake, I don't know where the government is up to on that, but it's certainly well short of the numbers which were promised, and I've not heard Mr. Dutton explain why that is the case, and the need is demonstrably there. So I agree with you, that should occur. In terms of some of the other issues, without wanting to sort of go through all of the chapter and verse in response to Simon, The Labor Party has adopted the position, which I know some people don't share, around offshore processing. What I would say is the support for that, I do not think means we can support some of the way in which the government is handling those detention facilities. And the reality is they have turned into centres of almost indefinite detention. with a lot of concerns being raised publicly about the circumstances in which people who are under our care are being held. And I think it's all very well to talk tough about this, but it was never envisaged that those facilities should become centres of indefinite detention.
Madam Vanstone.
Yes, I'm the only one that's actually had this job, and it's a shocker of a job being the Immigration Minister. It really is. Whatever you do, no one's happy. I think it's a very sad state of affairs when Australia is, I think, the first or second most generous country in terms of permanently resettling refugees, and most Australians wouldn't realise that. They don't, not proud of what we've done, because that great story gets overtaken. One of the Indonesian ministers said to me, if you take the sugar off the table, the ants will stop coming. And you just have to have, if you want to maintain an immigration policy that
just
has...
Just not to refer to refugees as ants, though.
Well, no, but he's not doing that. He's trying to make the analogy that, and I think quite effectively, that if you make it easier for people to choose you as a destination, there's no right for a refugee to choose where they go. I don't have that right. They're entitled to, get asylum, and it should be from the first country. Mm. We're a long way away from most of these countries. So I just make the point, if we've got strong borders, you can have a bigger, stronger immigration program, bring more people in, increase your refugee intake, increase your other intake, your normal skilled migration intake, because Australians don't feel threatened by the program. Why do we have this problem on Manus? Because the Rudd-Gillard policy was the greatest social policy failure Australia has ever had. We had stopped the boats and they started coming. We had people dying at sea. We had thousands of people coming in. I was the minister that had one kid in detention from an illegal arrival because the mother just had the baby. She wanted to stay with the father. And we ended up with thousands of kids. I mean, let's not forget where this problem started. It's not being solved as quickly as I would like, but let's not forget where it started. And if you have strong borders, you'll have a strong immigration program. Where did I learn that? Mick Young, former Labor minister, said, if you don't keep your program at a level and with community support, you'll lose your immigration program. Why is that important? Because that's what we are. We're an immigration country. Unless you're an Indigenous full blood, you've got migrant blood in your veins. And the only question is, when did your granny come or your granny come or something else? We are an immigration country, so we must keep that immigration system with public support.
So
let that
just,
fall
just
away,
very briefly, Amanda, because we have to move on.
I'll finish
that. Thank you very much. But were you party to discussions in the Howard government when the last people remaining on Nauru in your government were brought back to Australia?
Well, I was the minister who brought some of them back.
Yeah. So it was possible to bring them back to Australia without causing
some.
The boats to restart.
Is that the point? Some. But you cannot shift to a policy that says, don't worry, you just be 2 years there and then you'll be in. Because, look, I don't say this is not our problem. We are, as you say, world citizens of the world. And I'm pleased we're taking people from whatever country it is in South America, because our immigration program and our refugee program, this is a big failure from the UN, incidentally, a real stuff up on their part, because we used to work with them, we still do. Where will we take our refugees from? You know, when Bosnia was in trouble, we took a lot. When there was Sudan, we took a lot from there.
But the numbers and now, what Amanda, but hold on, what well they've, beyond.
Can, hold on, I don't interrupt you. The important thing is that you can work with the UN on the places most in need. And what they've done, by not supporting us as they should have for strong border policies, is they've allowed the people smugglers to decide who will get into Australia. And I will always take someone from a camp who's got no bloody money, can't pay a people smuggler, has lived in a camp for 15 years because no one wants them. I'll take them over someone who's got 10 grand to give a people smuggler for every member of their family.
Okay, let's move on. We've got other questions we need to get to. The next one is from Dion Pietrasanti. Thank you.
The role of a politician is to represent the people of Australia, and Pauline Hanson was represented by the people to represent the people. Sorry, she was elected by the people to represent the people. While I might not agree with everything that she says, Penny Wong, how can you argue that she peddles prejudice and fear when her views coincide with 49% of Australians, including 40% whom identify themselves as Labor voters?
Okay, those figures are drawn from the Essential poll.
How can I argue that Pauline Hanson peddles prejudice and fear? Because I look at what she says. And I remember the debate in the 90s when we were the ones who were swamping Australia and we were the ones who were going to make this a dreadful place. Yes, she is elected. She has her seat in the Senate and she's entitled to speak. But those of us who have very different views are also entitled to speak. And I would say this again. Prejudice and fear will never build a community. They will only tear one apart. No country has ever made itself safer by attacking a particular ethnic minority.
Simon Birmingham.
My last outing with you, Tony, I think was sharing a panel with Pauline, and on that occasion I said we should call out and condemn those who vilify, those who attack. And of course we should. We absolutely should. I also made the point, though, that we have to be very careful and recognise that close to 600,000 Australians did vote for One Nation, and we have to work really hard as representatives to explain to those Australians why it is that the types of policies we have can ensure the safety of Australians, can ensure the successful continual growth of our economy, can ensure that we actually can continue to take, as we were just discussing before, one of the world's most generous intakes of refugees, successfully resettle them as part of an even bigger immigration program, and that there's nothing to be afraid of from that because we have great world-class resettlement policies and programs in place in Australia. We have one of the world's most successful economies with a record of growth, the envy of every other developed nation, and that these are the things we need to make sure people understand, that we want to take all Australians with us, ensure their economic security, their job security, the security of the nation, and that of course is also underpinned by continuing to protect the freedoms, including religious freedoms, that we actually should treasure as Australians.
Okay, those figures there came from the Essential poll I think we were talking about, and it makes one wonder whether the idea of banning Muslim immigration or suspending Muslim immigration to this country has entered the political mainstream. That's really what the question was about. Do you think that's the case?
Look, those figures surprised me, I'd have to say. I haven't looked at how the poll was undertaken or the specific questions, but they show we've got a lot more work to do as elected representatives overall to make sure the support for non-discriminatory migration programs is maintained. Penny made the point before about why is it the government isn't successfully taking and resettling as many people from Syria as fast as some might like. Why? Well, one of the reasons there is because we are being as stringent as we possibly can in terms of the screening, the security analysis, the types of things that Australians expect us to do. And they are the types of messages we have to continually reinforce to try to drive down those statistics and maintain public support for all elements of our migration program.
All right, Jay Weatherill, were you surprised by that?
I was surprised but not shocked, because what the popular discourse has equated the Muslim faith with terrorism. So we see probably people being confused about those two ideas. I mean, South Australia has, I think, a very successful history of multiculturalism. It's very much in the DNA of our state. We were established as a state, as a province, with no established religion. This was a change compared with the other places around the nation, around the world. And I think we've taken that idea of tolerance and acceptance, and now we're adding to it, I think, an even deeper understanding of other cultures. And this is really very powerful for our state. It means that we can reach out to the world, build international relationships, including with Southeast Asia, where there are massive opportunities for prosperity for our state, and many of those nations are Muslim nations. And so we need to enjoy good relationships with people of other religions. Now, we have an Australian constitution that contains a provision, section 116, which essentially outlaws the discrimination on the basis of religion. It would be odd to me if we were running a national immigration program which was inconsistent with those basic tenets of freedom of religion.
Madam Vanstone, you have to keep it brief because
I agree with both of them. I agree with what you said, Jay, but I also agree with what Simon said. And I'll just take you back to the Lindt Cafe disaster. You be the minister that signs, or the department or secretary, whoever, signs okay for someone to come in and something goes wrong, and the people will want to, understandably, because we don't like terrorism, and we always say, who stuffed up? Let's go back and find it out. So you've got to expect, and we do expect, not just because they want to avoid being fingered, but we want ASIO and ACES to do their jobs properly and make sure that the people who come in are safe. So, I think that's an important point. The other aspect of the Hansen thing is my own view as to why Trump, inexplicably, is doing so well in the United States, is typified by Hillary's comment, the basket of deplorables. If we can't have a civil debate and say that you've got views with which I don't agree without saying you're deplorable, you're from a basket of deplorables, those people who think things that I don't think, think, well, up you, Jack. I'm sick of you treating me as if I'm an ignoramus. I've got a vote too. I've got these views. And I think it's come about through a lack of sufficient respect from the political elites for people who have a different view.
Okay, let's move on.
Can I just make one point on that? There does seem to be an enormous amount of focus given to Pauline Hanson's right to speak, or the right of people to vote for her, the right of those who voted for her to have their views expressed. I would like it injected in this conversation, perhaps the right of Muslim Australians to not be vilified. And maybe leaders should start talking about that.
Okay, that's a good place to leave that part of the discussion. The next question is a video. It's from Brad Blanchard in the United States.
My name is Brad Blanchard. I'm a fifth-generation fisherman from Grand Isle, Louisiana. We were ground zero for the BP oil spill. The effects this disaster had on our community and our fisheries are still being felt today, 6 years later. My question to you, Mr. Weatherill, is are you really going to stand by and let BP drill in the Great Australian Bight, in a marine sanctuary which houses mammals such as whales and dolphins and various other sea life?
Jay Weatherill.
Well, BP, as I understand it, have applied for an exploration licence in the Great Australian Bight. That is essentially being supervised or analysed by a federal agency called NOPSEMA, which is undertaking their analysis. And so that federal agency will give them that exploration licence or otherwise. I've met with BP and I've insisted on two things, to the extent that I can within the state's areas of responsibility. One is that they take every possible step to make transparent, essentially, the studies, the information they have about their plans. The second thing that we need to be satisfied about as a state is that the technologies that they're using and, frankly, the risk mitigation that they put in place are going to be effective to protect us against a potential risk. Now, these are matters which ultimately will be determined by the federal agency, and we've made our views very clear to that agency. But we won't be substituting our opinion. We'll be allowing those expert agencies to make their judgments about the safety or otherwise of these matters, and that will determine the issue.
Okay, as a specific question to you, we'll move on to other subjects. The next question is from Paul Gunner.
Hello, panel. Thank you. Minister.
Just before you say, whoever's yelling out, we can't hear what you're saying. There's no microphone on you, and there won't be. Okay, go ahead, Paul.
Thank you, Tony. Minister Birmingham, my question is in relation to vet fee help. If you'd agree that a nation of skilled trades is a public good, and I'm sure you would agree with that, why is it that your government is promoting a punitive policy of vet fee help and trade loans, in the absence of good empirical data on that, which often only goes to line the pockets of unscrupulous training providers and leaves young people, young apprentices, with massive debt. So I'd ask you if you could respond to that. Thanks.
Thanks, Paul. I don't agree that VET fee help is a punitive policy. If anything, I think it has proven to be a far too generous regime that was initially established to basically say students pursuing a vocational pathway should have the same rights for their fees to be paid by the government as a university student does. And then the same expectations that they'll only have to pay that fee back when they earn a decent income, just like a university student. So far from being punitive from the student's perspective, what VET fee help was trying to do was actually say, let's bring those vocational pathways up to the same standard of treatment for students as we give to university students in terms of that support, so those students don't have to pay out of their own pocket upfront fees, but they actually get that support from government. But the VET fee help scheme was poorly designed, and particularly the opening up that occurred in the previous Labor years was poorly designed. And I've made it pretty clear that there is a radical rewrite into a new scheme coming very, very soon for VET fee help. That 2017 will mark a new scheme being put in place, because we are seeing not just millions or hundreds of millions, but billions of dollars that sadly have been wasted under this scheme. And we've tried to fix it, and those fixes sadly have not worked over the last couple of years sufficiently so. So a new scheme has to be put in place that preserves that fundamental principle, which is vocational education students deserve the same rights and opportunities to not have to pay upfront fees as university students, but we have to make sure that there aren't shonks and fraudsters in the vocational education sector free to just rip the taxpayer and those students off in the process.
Quickly go to Penny Wong. Did Labor get this one wrong?
I don't think we got the principle wrong, but I think it's very clear that the system is in need of greater reform. We went to the election with a range of policies about that. But can I just pick up on something I think the gentleman was also referencing, which is apprenticeships? I mean, one of the things I think that is striking, and Simon probably has the data in his head more than I, but is the drop-off in apprenticeships in Australia. And you see that across the nation. You also see that in South Australia, and that, I think, is a problem for our economy, and it is a problem for an economy that's trying to transition and an economy that's trying to upskill its people. So, you know, that is something we were very focused on the last election. I suspect you'll see a lot more policy from Labor over the next couple of years on that.
I've got time for one last question. I'm going to go to it so that we can have the whole panel discuss this. It's from David Hunter.
Penny Wong, considering that if Labor blocks the same-sex plebiscite, there is no chance the law would pass before the next election in 2019, would it not be a smarter move to pass the legislation so that we could have a decision early next year?
I'll come to you afterwards, Penny. You just were speaking. I'll go, first of all, to Amanda Vanstone on this one.
Well, I think the answer to that's yes.
Okay, well, that's a nice brief one. Jay Weatherill.
Well, there's another simple solution. The federal parliament could get on with the business of passing the same-sex marriage legislation.
Is that even possible?
Yes.
When the government takes it to an election and gets effectively a mandate to have a plebiscite?
Well, it's down to the people in this room, it's down to the people in the broader community to make their voices heard about this issue. And look, this is simply a question of respect. It's a pretty fundamental question of respect. People that choose to celebrate their love by asking for the state to permit them to marry in the same way as any other couple would want to, that right, and seems to be a very simple thing to ask for. I mean, there's a lot of hate in the world. People want to celebrate their love, and we want to deprive them of that. I mean, what on earth are we doing?
Matt Evanson, this is jumping.
Well, look, I gave the direct, short, simple answer, but Jay does invite an elaboration of that. A bill came before Parliament and I were there, I'd vote for it. Penny knows that. We've had this discussion before. Society is made up of people who agree to be interdependent on each other, and we should be delighted that people are prepared to commit and happy to support that. I'm all for that. But the plain facts are, we went to the election with this policy that was decided in the previous parliament, and we were elected. Now, I don't put a lot of money on the races. I sometimes bet on the Melbourne Cup, not for the last 5 or 6 years. But I tell you what, if I did, and another horse beat my horse by a nose, I wouldn't expect to say, well, I want half the winnings. I lost. And plain facts are, we had a minority Labor government that lost. We've now got a slim majority Liberal government. That's the policy they went to the election with. So that's what we're dealing with. This is not a question of people not respecting. I know most of the people I know in the Liberal Party, or are friends with anyway, are going to vote yes. They're going to vote yes. It's not about that. This issue
is about... It's not about that.
Somebody
it's about
got elected
you're not
promising
friends
with. This. We can go ahead and do it, or you guys who didn't win can pretend that you did.
OK, Penny Wong.
Well, let's understand what the plebiscite is. And I thought quite a lot about this before I came out against a plebiscite for the reasons I've outlined, which I'm happy to go through, but I don't think we've got time. But let's understand what a plebiscite is about. A plebiscite is all about the internal politics of the Liberal Party. It's not about actually delivering marriage equality. It's about Malcolm Turnbull and Simon trying to placate the members of the right of the Liberal Party, because they don't want a free vote. Now, the day after Tony Abbott's very lengthy, remember the six-hour party room meeting? Simon was out publicly saying that people would have a free vote from the next election, that the Liberal Party would have a free vote from the next election. Well, they're not. So Turnbull's policy is actually worse than Abbott's was post that party room meeting. But can I just say this? I accept that Simon, Amanda and a whole range of moderate Liberals have got a position that is similar to mine on the principle of equality. What I find extraordinary is George Christensen is willing to cross the floor and hold the government to ransom on high-income superannuation tax breaks, but no one in the moderates of the Liberal Party is prepared to put the pressure on and say, we want to vote in the parliament, because that's what the Australian people want. And I think this issue, I'm really tired of talking about it. I'd just like to get it done.
Penny, the questioner made the obvious point that it might be delayed until 2019 the vote doesn't happen. Does that matter?
It might, but I think Jay actually made the right point. Parliament doesn't exist in a sort of... I know Canberra does seem like a spaceship at times, but it's not. And we are all elected and we all respond to the community, and I think we should be putting the pressure on. I think we should be saying we don't want a plebiscite that was dreamt up by Corey Bernardi and the Australian Christian Lobby, who will never agree with marriage equality. We want to vote in the parliament. And the thing about... The strategy, I understand why Malcolm and Simon and others have gone through this process, but you can't ultimately negotiate with prejudice. And the reality is the people inside the Liberal Party who are opposed to marriage equality will never change their mind. Erica Betts has made that clear. Even if the plebiscite were to succeed in the parliament and even were it to succeed in the community, he will still vote against it.
But so what?
Simon, Amanda, I've got it. We're running out of time. Simon Birmingham has to respond to this, and then we have to finish the program.
2009 was when I first publicly spoke in favour of marriage equality. Sure. Back then, back then, Penny, the Labor Party's position was opposition. And as you've said publicly many times, you stood by the Labor Party position when it was to oppose marriage equality, but worked internally to change it. And over that time, I've worked
half a decade
to change.
Ago. Half a decade
and over
ago.
That time, and you still half don't, and you still don't have everything you want out of the Labor years. Platform and policy. Yeah. It's still, you've forced
just
to
give
have
us a, vote.
A yes vote.
Just
that is
that
we want to give
the
these people a vote. We want to give all the right, audience a vote. We want to give Australians
you
a vote.
You didn't agree with that before.
And Penny?
He likes
Penny,
community
can
consultation.
Can I actually get my words out here on this issue? I've worked to change the Liberal Party policy. Just as you haven't achieved everything you want from Labor's policy, I've come to a position where we took to the last election a plebiscite.
Corey Bernardi's policy
and
is what
And what the Labor
got.
Party, and what the Labor Party, well, no, Corey would rather there wasn't a plebiscite as well. He'd rather the issue
he
stayed as a no
plebiscite.
Position.
He advocated for a plebiscite. He advocated for a plebiscite.
He advocated for a no vote, full stop. But Penny, you've actually got the opportunity now to see this issue resolved, to seize the opportunity and have marriage equality as law in Australia by March year next year, with the type of support that comes from the public having endorsed it. My concern now is, even if the Parliament railroaded it through, it would become such a controversial issue in the public that we wouldn't stop talking about the issue. because we've built up this expectation that Australians get to have their say on it. And I think the best thing we can do now is let Australians have their say and hope and believe, as I do, that there will be a strong yes vote and that it will actually be a really positive thing for gay and lesbian Australians to get that public endorsement of a change that actually then comes into law.
We do have to stop talking about it because we're out of time. Penny Wong, final quick word.
58 gay and lesbian organisations have come out against it. You've already had Liberal Party members distributing material which attacks our children. Yes, we can have this. We can have a vote. Just give people a free vote. Just bring it into the parliament and give people a free vote. We don't have to spend $200 million, which frankly would be far better spent.
We can give Australians a free vote and have it all resolved.
Okay, that's all we have time for tonight. Please thank our panel, Amanda Vanstone, Jay Weatherill, Simon Birmingham and Penny Wong. Thank you, and a special thanks to Her Majesty's Theatre and this great Adelaide audience. Give yourselves a quick round of applause. Thank you. Okay, this week the Turnbull government signalled a major overhaul of Australia's welfare system. Next week we'll be joined by the man who's driving those changes, Social Services Minister Christian Porter, with Shadow Minister for Climate and Energy Mark Butler, Media Executive Marina Gose, Social Equity Advocate Eva Cox, and Policy Analyst Tricia Jarre. Until next Monday's Q&A, good night.